Bonjour. Bonjour les amis. Bienvenue chez Véro. Everybody hears me? Salut Oliver. I know it's your favorite song, Oliver. I'm playing it for you a little bit. Because I know you love that song. Bonjour Sylvain. We're about to start Apéro with Véro number 8. We've been doing this for 2 months already, believe it or not. Yes, it's La Bohème by the great Charles Aznavour. A very sad song. Merci, Missy. Glad you can hear me. I see familiar faces and names here. 71 people here already. 74. Les habitués are here. Le huitième apéro, the 8th one. That's right, Sylvain. And we're going to Montmartre today. Hence the song. Yes, give me some little hearts if you like Montmartre. Or the apéro with Véro. Bonjour Kim, Woodenville is here. I'm just going to wait a little bit longer and then we'll start. You know, Oliver, I won't sing. The weather is gorgeous. Come on. It's a sad song. Oh, come on. Bohème. Bonjour, Seattle. 87. Oh, you know, it's the story of that guy who used to be an artist in Montmartre and returns years later and remembers La Bohème, the bohemian life that he left behind. And it's sad, but at the same time, it's very nostalgic and he kind of makes it sound like he misses it, though he's become a hugely successful artist around the world. That would be Charles Aznavour. He misses his days as a starving artist and the woman he shared them with. All right, we'll wait for the end and then we'll go. Ne veux plus rien dire du tout. The Bohème doesn't mean anything anymore. Oh, come on, Charles, cheer up. I'll let him finish that beautiful song. Don't want to cut him off. Bienvenue, les amis. Bonjour à tout le monde. 95 people here. Hey, Google. Volume 1. All right. Charles, Charles, Charles. Merci beaucoup. Alors, attends. Hop. Et voilà, Véro. Comment ça va? Ça va? Tout le monde va bien? Alors, musique, lumière, we've got what we need. Bonjour, bonjour à tous. My name is Véro, France with Véro, otherwise known as French Girl in Seattle Online. This is my 8th Apéro with Véro, which is a weekly event, a Saturday event we've been having through the confinement. And even though the confinement ended at the beginning of the week in France, I thought I would do a couple more because you seem to have enjoyed them. And what we do here is we talk about France and Paris, Paris and France, but we try to look at aspects of French culture that maybe are not discussed quite as often as others, and we use a song to do that. So today, I told you, we are going to Montmartre. Salut mon frère, my brother is here. Bonjour Georges. Say hi to my brother, you guys, his name is Georges. I'm flattered the family's here and my friends too. Salut Claudine. Good, good, good. Alors, nous allons commencer. Je vais préparer I am going, I thought I was with my French students and I started speaking French, but some of you understand, I know. So we are going, and you know, it's always a bit of a challenge since with Instagram, I can only shoot vertically. So you end up looking at the keyboard a little bit, but hopefully that's good enough. 107 people here. Wonderful. Hey, Georges, look, you're getting all these hi, friendly hellos. Aren't my friends nice? I see Georges with an S and Georges without an S. In French, there is an S, and in English, in America, there is no S. It's the difference. We pronounce it Georges here. Okay, so is everybody ready to go to Montmartre? Oui? I will assume you're saying yes, because there is a delay in the comments, right? So Montmartre, my little friends, it's this great neighborhood that I know some of you have visited already. And this is Paris, and this is the Seine River. This is the left bank, and this is the right bank. And I like this map because this map doesn't show the arrondissement. It shows, you know, the administrative districts in Paris. What it shows is actually the neighborhood names. So I really like this little map. Also, it's very cheerful. I prefer life in color. So Montmartre, I could do a quiz, but I know many of you will get it right. It's right here, that section above the green, it says Montmartre. I hope you can read it. So now, that's right, Oliver. Some of you live in Montmartre and you are very lucky. I need to go back to Montmartre very soon. My friend Lily Heis of Je T'aime Me Neither also lives in Montmartre. I have a few friends there. Yes, it is a great map, isn't it? So while I do the presentation, I may not see the comments. Feel free to chat amongst yourselves as you always do. But I may not see the comments. I usually go back to them later. So don't be offended if I don't reply to your comments because I'm focusing on the screen. All right, so let's go to Montmartre, this iconic neighborhood that you've all heard about. And this is probably one of the most iconic scenes in Montmartre. Montmartre is a hill. It's called La Butte, B-U-T-T-E. The French will say La Butte de Montmartre. It's one of the highest points, if not the highest point in Paris. And this beautiful church, well, some people don't think it's beautiful. This church is a basilica and it's known as the Sacré-Cœur. And it was built in the late 19th century and inaugurated in the early 20th century. It just sits at the very top of the hill. This is another iconic site in Montmartre, but this one sits at the very bottom of the hill, and it's a lovely square called Les Abbesses. Les Abbesses, because there was an abbey there a long time ago. It's also one of the deepest, if not the deepest, metro station in Paris, and what you're looking at is part of a beautiful metro entrance that was designed by Hector Guimard during the Art Nouveau time, a long time ago. But it is a very special place. If you arrive by the metro and the elevators are not working to bring you up to daylight, I recommend you brace yourself because there are a lot of stairs, winding stairs to get back up to fresh air and the light. So good luck, my friends. Yes, les escaliers des abbesses. The thing about Montmartre is that Montmartre has retained its charm. Montmartre was always picturesque. It always felt like a village. It did way back when, and it still does today. If you can catch Montmartre early in the morning, and those who live there would probably say this, if you can catch it early in the morning, you will feel like you are still in a village. You never, ever, ever want to go on a sunny Sunday, because Sunday is the Parisians love going to Montmartre on a Sunday, so you will be fighting off hordes of tourists and the Parisians on a Sunday. Okay, so a great time to go is probably early in the morning and never on a Sunday. Montmartre has always attracted artists. You've heard the stories. If you've taken a tour of Montmartre with a reputable tour guide, I've taken several tours of Montmartre in English last year as I was training to become a tour guide, and all the tours were excellent, and all the tours mentioned a lot of the artists that lived and worked in this area. This gentleman is not a well-known artist, unless I'm mistaken, but you don't have only famous artists. In fact, a lot of the ones we call famous today, like Van Gogh or Renoir or Utrillo or Suzanne Valadon, these guys were not always famous at the time. There is a special place there by the Basilica called La Place du Tertre where you can see the artists. That's something else you should be ready for. You should be ready for stairs. There are stairs all over La Butte. Of course, it's a hill. So at some point you need to go up. Well, again, if you hire a reputable tour guide, they should be able to take you around slowly without taking any stairs and without getting out of breath all the way to the top. So pick your guides right, my friend. Now, a long time ago, before Montmartre became a very touristy place that welcomes about, I think, 12 million visitors a year, 12 million visitors in what is essentially a small village, Montmartre was also a very rural place. It wasn't even part of Paris. For the longest time, it sat outside the city limits. It was cheap, it was rural, and there were windmills and fields and gardens. And people came there to drink, to party, the Parisians, because it was so cheap to do that there. And in fact, before I go on to the next one here, you have to know that a lot of people came to Montmartre also in the 19th century when the Industrial Revolution happened and cities started to grow and more people moved to cities. A lot of people could not afford to live in Paris. So what did they do? They moved out to the faubourg, the suburbs outside Paris, and Montmartre attracted people who were down on their luck, farmers who'd lost their land, starving artists, factory workers, and those are the people who you would have found there in the 19th century. But not all of it always looked as glorious as this beautiful painting. Montmartre was not all colors and beautiful life and artists painting and cabarets and fun nightlife. There was also a grim side to Montmartre. And some people have never seen these photos. These photos are a section of Montmartre that used to be known as Le Maquis. Now, I don't know if you know what the word maquis means in French, M-A-Q-U-I-S. The maquis is really a type of landscape you see in Corsica or in other Mediterranean climates. It's very thick and it's hard. It's very dry, very thick, and it's hard to get into. In fact, during World War II, during the German occupation, the term people used to refer to joining the resistance was to enter the maquis. When they said he joined the maquis, it meant he joined the resistance because the Germans supposedly couldn't find them where they went, in the woods, etc. So the maquis was also in Montmartre, and this is where a lot of the people down on their luck I described earlier settled down. And this area, if you'd like to know exactly where it was, if you know Montmartre a little bit, it was between the Rue Caulaincourt and the Rue Le Pic, and eventually it got torn down when they carved in there the Avenue Junot. So the Avenue Junot ended up going right in the middle of it. So it was big in the late 19th century, early 20th. By 1940, it was gone. It was a urban sprawl had taken it all down. But it was there for several decades, and it was essential to life in Montmartre. It wasn't all good news. They weren't just people down on their luck there. There were also criminals, a lot of criminals. And let's see. I want to show you more pictures. This is Caulaincourt, and you see the maquis on the right. Do you see the Sacré-Cœur on the top of the hill here? So this is Montmartre a long time ago with those. It's a shanty town. Dirt roads, wood shacks, no running water, unsanitary. People were very, very poor in Le Maquis. These were the unsavory characters who lived there. They were known all over Paris, especially by the bourgeoisie. They were known as les Apaches, the Apaches. And there were gangs. They were gangs like we have today, fighting off each other. And they were, you know, spread out all around Paris, in Belleville, in Charonne, in Montmartre. These guys were criminals. They had knives. they would kill bourgeois, they would burglarize homes, they would rob people in the street, they would kill people, the police was always chasing them. And some of them have made it into books and movies. But when you hear about les Apaches, it's a little bit weird, but the Apaches were actually in Paris, believe it or not. We're not in a Western movie here. So Le Maquis had all sorts of interesting people. And of course, Le Maquis had children. There were children there who grew up in the street and had to grow very, very fast. Because they were poor, their parents were poor, and it was really hard for them in Le Maquis. Here's another picture. It's not very good, but you can see some of them here with a lady who's watching over them. But you see the steps going up the Butte and all these shacks where they lived. So in Montmartre, it wasn't just the artistic tradition. In Montmartre, there has been a philanthropic tradition for over 100 years. And a lot of people have taken care of these children, have actually paid attention to these children. And it started a long, long time ago with a great guy I'm going to talk to you about today. This is not the stories you'll hear on a tour of Montmartre. On a tour of Montmartre, you're going to hear stories about Van Gogh and Utrillo and Renoir and Toulouse-Lautrec. On all the tours I've taken 3 or 4 tours of Montmartre. They were all great. That person only got a mention in passing, and I think that's so unfair. So I thought today I would actually do that gentleman justice and focus on him for our presentation. And I hope you agree with me at the end that he deserved it. Montmartre has a motto, by the way. I don't know if you're aware of that. The motto of Montmartre is faire le bien dans la joie, to do some good joyfully. And if there is one person who embodies this philosophy, this motto, it is the gentleman I am going to introduce you to now. Some of you may recognize him. His name is Francisque Poulbot, P-O-U-L-B-O-T. He was fairly young still when that picture was taken. What I like about Poulbot was that he was a real Montmartrois. He was a real artist in residence. He didn't just go through Montmartre for a few years like Picasso, then move on. Now, when I said nobody mentions him, some people do mention him probably, but I just think people are more interested in Van Gogh or Renoir. But I think this guy here really represents Montmartre and lived there all of his life. And we're going to see some of the great things that he did that still continue today. Okay, which is why he's here in this presentation. Here's an older picture of Poulbot. You can see he looks a lot more successful there. He's got a beautiful bow tie and a cigarette and his beautiful pardessus, his coat. He did become a very popular, he was a poster, a painter or a poster artist. He was a cartoonist and an illustrator. But he used his art. So he was an artist from Montmartre too, right? But he did so many other things thanks to his art or through his art. Now, Francisque Poulbot moved to Montmartre from Saint-Denis, which is nearby. And he lived in Montmartre for the rest of his life. He got married in Montmartre. In fact, he and his wife at the beginning of the 20th century lived at that beautiful museum you know today as the Musée Montmartre. People always mention Renoir lived there. But Suzanne Valadon lived there and her studio's there, but few people mention Poulbot. He actually lived in that building as well, which, by the way, is a fantastic museum, Le Musée Montmartre, one of my favorite smaller museums in Paris, especially if you like the history of Montmartre. His name was Poulbot. I think somebody's asking for his name, P-O-U-L-B-O-T. You will see the name a little later on, hopefully. So, as I said, he started before World War I doing some advertising posters that were commissioned. Here you can see that he draws a picture of this little boy warming himself up by this wood stove called Mirus, that was the brand at the time. And this is Poulbot's style. Very few people have seen his original style. And the little boy is clearly not a wealthy little boy. His shoes, his clothes are torn. This is a poor little boy from Montmartre. And we will see that these kids were essential to what he did. This is a poster that was commissioned by the famous department store on the left bank, Le Bon Marché, Au Bon Marché. And you have to know, this one was from 1919, right after World War I. So there is a theme here that Poulbot used a lot in his illustrations. Poulbot was very patriotic, and during the war, all of the illustrations that he did had a patriotic or patriotic message. It's hard for me to say that word. You see this? This is a toy of a German soldier that says made in Germany. As it turns out, before World War I, the toy market in France was cornered by Germany, and Poulbot did not like it. There was this resentment, you know, since the defeat in 1870, there was a resentment towards Germany. So the soldier, the toy, is on the floor. The two little kids, the little kid defeated him here with a sword, and Le Bon Marché lets people know that from September 2nd, the new toys made in France will be ready at the store. And it says here in the caption, and now, long live the French toy. So this is a typical Poulbot type of illustration with a patriotic message highlighting the children, featuring kids. I love this picture. This is one of the few pictures I've been able to find of Poulbot with the kids from Montmartre, from Le Maquis. You can see in this picture that the children are poor. You can see that they are very cold. It's just a ghastly day in Montmartre. And you can see that they're looking at him because he's probably painting them. So what he did is that his main mission in life throughout the war and after the war, World War I, was to become le père des gosses. That was his nickname. That became his nickname, the father of the kids. And he wanted to give them a voice, these poor kids in Montmartre, through his illustrations. He wanted people to realize what was happening in Montmartre, in Le Maquis, to those kids and why it was important to help them. Here are some of the cute, adorable illustrations that he did. But don't let the style fool you. Even though these illustrations and depictions of kids' lives in Montmartre are loving and even funny, they're also very sad. And two of the main themes in Poulbot's illustrations were poverty and the impact of war on the kids. We will see that a little bit further down. But all these kids that he draws are the typical Montmartre kids and who later become Montmartre adults. They are cheeky and they are bold. They you know, they have strong personalities and that kind of shoot from the hip sense of humor. So this little boy here, they're all poor little kids from Montmartre, and these two are kind of looking at his hat. He just went to get some water. There's no running water. So he just went to the fountain to bring some water back to his home. And he's wearing this fancy hat. So the little boy on the right just asks him, you know, what about this hat? And he answers, it's a hat somebody gave me, but don't go and assume I can't afford to buy my own things. So there is the poor kid who's extremely proud. And he doesn't want to admit he doesn't have the money to buy the hat. This is another illustration of the typical cheeky, bold character personality of these children in Montmartre. This little boy is clearly a poor little boy. Look, his pants are all torn on his bum there. His shoes are, you know, falling apart. He is peeing against the fence. And those two little elegant little girls, clearly not from the Maquis, are walking by and they act horrified because they will make fun of him because he's peeing on the fence. And so he looks back and he says, if you don't look, you won't see anything. And that's typical of the humor that those children had. But not all of it was funny. We have 148 people here today. Excellent. Welcome, everyone. I hope you enjoy this presentation. We're in Montmartre and we're in the past in Montmartre and we're talking about a wonderful Montmartre artist named Francisque Poulbot, an illustrator who did a lot of great things for the kids and the people in that neighborhood before World War II. So let's look at this. This is an ad, another commission from Le Bon Marché, the department store. And you can see that the theme of war is going to be there too. In 1918, this is for December of 1918, you have those two little girls and the older girl is helping the younger girl write a letter to Le Père Noël, Santa Claus. And I love that the letter has spelling mistakes in it. and it says, "My dear Noel, this year, don't forget with my toys to bring victory so my daddy can come back. I promise I will be very good." So this is very touching. It's war, it's how it's impacting children, and he's working for the Bon Marché and advertising their toys for Christmas, but at the same time, he gets his message across. He gets his solidarity across. Here is another example. Throughout World War I, the government and local authorities would organize fundraisers with the French to, prepare care packages for soldiers who were at the front. You all know how ghastly the Great War was, especially when it started in the trenches in 1915 and later. Well, here you see how the kids are impacted by war. He's using those children to appeal to the humanity of the people in Paris. There is a fundraiser organized in December of 1915, and those two children, so the little boy is dressed as a soldier, which in Poulbot's depictions, the kids always were the little boys, and the little girl is caring, and she's dressed as a nurse, and this represents the role that women played during the war. A lot of them were on the front, in the trenches, helping, being nurses. So you can see how it's all represented or depicted in there. And here's another one from 1916. It's a special day in Paris to benefit the wounded soldiers. These guys were known as les poilus, P-O-I-L-U-S, the hairy ones. They were the French infantry soldiers, and they were extremely, extremely brave, and the whole country fell in love with them. And so a lot of campaigns were organized to support them. And as you can see, again, the kids are totally wrapped up in the theme of war. You have the little boys dressed as soldiers, you have the French flag, the little girl, and here are the wounded soldiers walking by. Now, let's look at what Poulbot did. I told you he got, maybe I didn't tell you, he got the Legion of Honor after World War I, actually, for being such a patriot and for just kind of boosting the morale of Parisians by showing those children kind of, you know, keeping their chin up in spite of the war. So he was awarded the Legion of Honor after the war, but he didn't stop there. He still lived in Montmartre. There were still a lot of poor children, and hundreds of these kids had lost their fathers, their grandfathers, or whoever in the war. So they needed a lot of help. So he continued, he forged on. And through his work, he basically continued helping the people in the community. Now, I don't know how many of you are aware of this, but Montmartre is a very much a separate neighborhood from the rest of Paris, not just geographically. Montmartre likes to think it's different. It likes to think it's special. And Montmartre is organized in a république, a republic, just like France. Now, this is not really a political thing. This is something Poulbot and four of his artist friends created in 1920 and 1921. It was an association that was meant to help the poor kids in the neighborhood. And it's carried on until today. The gentleman you see in the center is the president of the République de Montmartre, and he has been for about 7 years, I think. These are the people helping him, and these are part of the band, the local band called the Poulbot. The name is still there. And all of that came from an idea of Francisque Poulbot in the 1920s after World War I. Now, what he did, you recognize this place? Some of you may have had yes, the newsletter is wonderful. I saw your message, Bob. You can subscribe to the newsletter of the République de Montmartre. And it goes to about, they have about 900 people, members around the world. So it's really fun. And they send you some news when they have special events, etc. This is à la Pomponnette, an iconic Montmartre restaurant that opened in 1909 and went down, you know, just through generations and unfortunately closed last fall. So we won't be able to eat there anymore. But know that back then, in 1923, Poulbot approached the gentleman who had created the restaurant and talked him into opening a clinic in the back of the restaurant for the kids in Montmartre. It was called a dispensaire. And it survived that clinic for at least 15 years. It doesn't exist today, but the association, of course, lived on. And now, of course, sadly, the Pomponnette is closed as well. But La République de Montmartre, the association, continues the fundraising. They continue helping children and needy people in the neighborhood. It's hard to picture when you go to Montmartre and you see all these tourists. And it doesn't feel like people say, I hate going there. There are too many tourists, too crowded. People forget it's also a real neighborhood. And actually, the people who have lived there for decades are very close-knit. It's a neighborhood where there is a real sense of community and they're really proud of their history. These are some of the things that Poulbot and his friends and the République de Montmartre organized. You can see their name here through the clinic. This, every Christmas, for years and years, every Christmas in through the 1930s, they organized special Christmas events for the kids, pour les gosses, the kids of Montmartre. And because Poulbot, as an artist, knew every cabaret, every business in town, he had made really good friends with Le Moulin de la Galette. I'm sure you've been there, that restaurant with the big windmill on top of it. And the Fratellinis were a really famous family involved in the circus. The circus was a huge deal in the 19th century and early 20th century. So every year at Christmas, the Fratellinis and the Moulin de la Galette would invite the poor kids of Montmartre, thanks to Poulbot and the République de Montmartre, to have a special Christmas celebration. You can see this poor little kid wearing rags, literally, and this woman who's wearing the Phrygian hat, which is the symbol of the French Republic. She's handing him out a beautiful little windmill as a Christmas toy. And the windmill, of course, represents the neighborhood because there used to be many, many windmills on the hills of Montmartre, on the hill of Montmartre for centuries, for a couple of centuries. Here they are checking in with whoever brought them in. You see this cute little thing here with the coat that's too big for him. And those ladies are taking their names down and smiling at them. And the events were closed off to other children. It was just for the kids from Montmartre. And some of them had to be there with an adult if they were too young. But the only adults allowed were the people who had actually donated money. Nobody else was allowed. It was just for them. Can you imagine how special they felt? Here they are after one of the representations. This is really, or the performances, I should say. You see one of the Fratellinis here, one of the clowns, another one here, and the little kids. Some of them look really impressed. Now, I bet you all recognize this place. I bet you've all walked past this place. It's called Le Clos Montmartre. It's one of the only surviving vineyards in Paris. And do you know why it's there? It's there thanks to Francisque Poulbot and his friends, once again. In the 1930s and 40s, the Maquis practically disappeared very quickly at that point because urban sprawl was everywhere. And they were starting to build those three-story buildings that Montmartre became really famous for. But Poulbot did not want urban sprawl. He did not want people to be kicked out of the neighborhood. So he really fought to save a place that was at the corner of La Rue des Saules and La Rue Saint-Vincent. And it remained vacant for a while. And then in 1933, the République de Montmartre decided to plant a vineyard there. And a year later, they harvested the first wine in 1934. And after that, it just went on and on and on. Well, it resumed after World War II. And today, if you go to Montmartre in October for the famous Harvest Festival, just know that the first one happened when Poulbot was still around. And here they are. All the members of the République de Montmartre with their president are here. They're the ones who start the party inside the vineyard. And all the kids who still represents the little Poulbot that Francisque Poulbot was helping are part of the festivities. Half a million people descend upon, well, no, wait, I should say, ascend to Montmartre, ascend to Montmartre every fall to attend this big event. So again, something we owe to Francisque Poulbot. Now, his life and my story is winding down. Francisque Poulbot had a very rough time in the later years of his life. He had a bone disease, and that's why he could only stay a fight in World War I for 1 year before he was sent home, and that bone disease would eventually take his life. He spent World War II and the occupation inside his house in a wheelchair, and the Germans who occupied Paris did not forget that during World War II, Mr. Poulbot had been advocating resistance against les Boches, the whatever the nickname is in English for les Boches, B-O-C-H-E-S, the Krauts, I guess. And they did not want him to leave his house. So during the whole German occupation, he was stuck inside his house in a wheelchair. He died a year after the war, after the liberation in 1946. And they buried him at the cemetery, the Montmartre cemetery. His grave is not easy to find, but I managed to find it 3 months ago when I went to pay my respects. And they have not forgotten him in Montmartre. For the 70th anniversary of his death, 3 or 4 years ago, they had a big celebration. Everybody from the Republic of Montmartre was there. They were singing. The Poulbots was there. So he certainly hasn't been forgotten. So before I wrap up this presentation, I just want to show you why Poulbot's legacy lives on. Not only was he an awesome guy, a wonderful human being, and a very talented artist, but he also inspired in many ways something that is part of Parisian life and has been for a really long time. You know these guys. You've seen these. These are known as les Poulbots. When I first moved to Paris in the 80s, I thought these were the original Poulbots. You see the ones with the big eyes that are really cute and look very Parisian. In fact, they are not Poulbot's characters, as you could tell from the ones I showed you earlier. The artist is named Michel Thomas. But this was from the 60s through the 80s, roughly. So you can see that Poulbot's legacy kind of lived on. But really, what Poulbot did is that with les Poulbots, les petits Poulbots, he launched another thing. A lot of people in Paris refer to les titis parisiens, les titis, T-I-T-I-S. And titi is a little French kid, a little Parisian kid from the street, from the working classes. And when I say that to you, I'm pretty sure you're immediately thinking of a famous one in French literature who is known Gavroche. And who is portrayed in Les Misérables, which Victor Hugo wrote in 1862. And Gavroche is the typical titi Parisien. You can also call him a Poulbot, really. He's street smart, he's cheeky, he's rebellious, he's resourceful, and it's a character everybody's familiar with. As it turns out, you know, les titi Parisiens existed before Poulbot. They weren't always known as les titis parisiens, but Delacroix, 30 years before Victor Hugo created Gavroche, actually showed a little boy here next to La Marianne in his famous painting, Liberty Leading the People, a little boy who could be a Gavroche, who could be a titi, who could be a Poulbot. So this imagery around the Parisian kid, the resourceful working class Parisian kid, has been around forever. And it is still around today. Singer Renaud, when he started his career in the 1980s, really posed as a Parisian titi. He spoke like one, he acted like one, he was very rebellious, he dressed like one. Edith Piaf, when she started in the streets of Belleville and Ménilmontant, was considered a titi as well. But this is the latest titi that movies have shown. You know Amélie, of course, Amélie Poulain, and she is the quintessential titi. A titi doesn't have to be a young kid. A titi doesn't have to be a boy. A titi can be a pretty girl who lives in Montmartre, has lived there all her life, is extremely resourceful, can be cheeky, knows Paris like the back of her hand, and is afraid of nothing. So I give you, you know, the new age titi Parisien or Poulbot, who is Amélie, in fact. So this is the end of my presentation, and I want to have time to take you through the song I have chosen for us today. I hope you have enjoyed this presentation on Francisque Poulbot, who was the authentic, I think an authentic Montmartrois resident, artist in residence, and a wonderful human being. And next time you see a statue, you can think about him. But today, though I played a song by Monsieur Aznavour at the beginning to fool some people, because people always associate Aznavour with La Bohème and Montmartre, I thought I'd pick a different song because I thought If Francisque Poulbot joined my apéro today, would he prefer I play Aznavour's La Bohème or this song? And this song is called Un gamin de Paris, a kid from Paris. It was written in 1951 and performed by a woman for the first time, but iconic French singer Yves Montand did it very well as well. And so I think I will show you the Montand version. You know Yves Montand, a great performer, a wonderful stage presence, a lot of charisma, started his career as an Edith Piaf protégé and lover, quite possibly, and went on to become an award-winning actor. And of course, his love story that spanned many decades with iconic actress Simone Signoret is the stuff that romantic legends are made of. So Simone Signoret, Yves Montand, they are buried together at the Père Lachaise. I always pay them a visit when I go to Père Lachaise. And he will sing this song for us today. So let's take a little break and see how you're doing. Thank you for listening to this presentation. My hair is getting very long. How are you? Yes, he was handsome. Yves Montand was really handsome. Simone Signoret was beautiful and Yves Montand was really handsome. So, what did you think of the presentation? You enjoyed it? No, we won't mention Marilyn Monroe because he had a lot of an affair with her that broke Simone's heart, and I don't think she quite recovered. But that's a different story, and it was their private life. So we won't go in that. We won't go there. So, if you have joined us a little later, I just took you on a stroll around Montmartre and talked to you about, I don't know, a face of Montmartre that people don't necessarily discuss, and a gentleman who doesn't get all the attention I think he should be getting, at least on guided tours and visits. His name was Francisque Poulbot, and I hope you agree with me at this point. I want to play that song for you, but just a little word. Thank you for all of you who've joined me for 8 weeks now. This is our 8th Apéro with Véro. Thank you very much. I want to thank as well the people who are supporting me through this new adventure. You know, I launched a new business at the beginning of the confinement when I lost my tour guiding assignments for who knows how long. So the new business is called France with Véro. I teach French online. You can find information about these at frenchgirlinseattle.com. I will be launching a new group or a new class based on travel that will be perfect for beginners. I've had many requests to offer a beginner level class. It's not a traditional beginner level class, but it will be focusing on communicating in travel situations. I did that in Seattle for many years, and I thought I would offer that probably in June. So look at the website in the next few days. It will be updated. I also want to thank all my patrons, the wonderful people who are basically paying my salary right now. I have 150 members. My goal is to have 300. And in return for their support, I give them special rewards. And just to give you a few, next week we will be meeting on a live event where we will be discussing another aspect of French language, but it will be more interactive than this one. I will be doing less talking, so they have a chance to interact with me. And it's called Conversation with Véro, so that's part of the Patreon rewards. And in the next few days, we will also be meeting for a Q&A, a chat on Facebook Live through the private Facebook group La Bande de Véro that I created for my patrons. So if you would like to look into Patreon, go to patreon.com, patreon.com/FrenchGirlInSeattle, and then you will see if there's a level of membership you're interested in. It starts at $5 a month. It's very affordable, and for me, it makes a big difference. So thank you very much for your support. Now, if you are ready for our song, we are looking to, we're going to look at a song, and that song I told you about, my apéro is going to get cut off short if I don't speed up a little. I've had that problem with my presentations. They're getting longer and longer and longer. All right, so this is our song here. We always look at the lyrics and translate them before we listen to the song. I think you can read, huh? It looks like it's pretty clear. So it's called Un gamin de Paris. I have prepared a translation, which I will be reading as I go. Un gamin de Paris, c'est tout un poème. Dans aucun pays, il n'y a le même. Car c'est un titi, petit gars dégourdi que l'on aime. A kid from Paris, that's a poem in itself. No other country is one just like him. Because he's a titi, a smart little guy we love. Un gamin de Paris, c'est le doux mélange d'un ciel affranchi du diable et d'un ange, et son œil hardi s'attendrit devant une orange. A kid from Paris is the sweet mix of a sky freed of a devil and an angel, and his bold eye softens up at the sight of an orange, which he probably steals, by the way. Pas plus haut que trois pommes, mais lance un défi à l'aimable bonhomme qui l'appelait mon petit. No bigger than a shrimp, he challenges the nice man who called him my little one. Un gamin de Paris, c'est une cocarde, bouton, qui fleurit dans un pot de moutarde. Il est tout l'esprit, l'esprit de Paris qui musarde. A kid from Paris, that's a tricolor cockade, sticking out in a mustard jar. He's the whole soul of Paris, Paris that wanders. Pantalon trop long pour lui, toujours les mains dans les poches. On le voit qui déguerpit, aussitôt qu'il voit un képi. His pants too long, always with his hands in his pockets. We see him running away as soon as he sees a policeman. Un gamin de Paris, c'est tout un poème. Dans aucun pays, il n'y a le même. Car c'est un titi, petit gars dégourdi que l'on aime. A kid from Paris, that's a poem in itself. No other country has one just like him. Because he's a titi, a smart little guy we love. Those are my favorite. That's my favorite part of the song. Il est l'héritier, lors de sa naissance, de tout un passé lourd de conséquences. Et ça, il le sait, bien qu'il ignore l'histoire de France. He was born the heir of a heavy past. He's aware of that, even if he doesn't know French history. Sachant que sur les places, pour un idéal, des petits gars pleins d'audace, à leur façon, firent un bal. He knows that out on some city squares, in the name of an ideal, bold little guys, in their own way, had a ball. Un gamin de Paris, rempli d'insouciance, gouailleur et ravi de la vie qui chante, s'il faut, peut penser aussi comme Gavroche, entrer dans la danse. A carefree kid from Paris, full of cheerful banter and happy about life, sings. But if he has to, like Gavroche, will join in the dance. Un gamin de Paris m'a dit à l'oreille, si je pars d'ici, sachez que la veille, j'aurai réussi à mettre Paris en bouteille. A kid from Paris whispered in my ear, if I leave this place, know that the day before, I will have managed to put Paris in a bottle. And isn't that a wonderful song? It was written by a great lady named Michelle in 1951 for a movie, actually. And she, you don't need to see this. I just need to play it. And then you want to see the words, sorry. Yeah, so she wrote the song for a movie in 1951. And the song became hugely famous because it so captured the spirit of those kids. Okay, so here we go, everybody ready? Un gamin de Paris by Monsieur Yves Montand. And I'll try to keep this steady.
Un gamin de Paris, c'est tout un poème. Dans aucun pays, il n'y a le même. Car c'est un titi, petit gars dégourdi que l'on aime. Un gamin de Paris, c'est le doux mélange d'un ciel affranchi, du diable et d'un ange. Et son œil hardi s'attendrit devant une orange. Un défi à l'aimable bonhomme qui l'appelait mon petit. Un gamin de Paris, c'est une cocarde, bouton qui fleurit dans un pot de moutarde. Il est tout l'esprit, l'esprit de Paris qui musarde. Pantalon trop long pour lui, toujours les mains dans les poches. On le voit qui déguerpit, aussitôt qu'il voit un képi. Un gamin de Paris, c'est tout un peu. poème dans aucun pays. Il n'y a le même, car c'est un titi, petit gars dégourdi que l'on aime. Il est héritier lors de sa naissance de tout un passé lourd de conséquences, et ça il le sait, bien qu'il ignore l'histoire de France. Sachant que sur les places, pour un idéal, des petits gars pleins d'audace, à leur façon virent un bal. Un gamin de Paris rempli d'insouciance, gouailleur et ravi de la vie qui chante, s'il faut, peut aussi, comme Gavroche, entrer dans la danse. Manif à l'oreille, si je pars d'ici, sachez que la veille j'aurais réussi à mettre Paris en bouteille.
Merci Monsieur Montand, merci beaucoup. Ok. Whoops. What did we think? Isn't that a great song? And the accordion, how perfect. And raise your hand if you would like to be able to put Paris in a bottle so you can have it with you right about now, like this titi parisien when he one day will leave Paris. Isn't that a great idea? Belle chanson. Yes, I know. It's a great song. It's beautiful. And it fits so well with the theme, right? I think Francisque Poulbot, if he could have heard this presentation, would have really liked it. I hope so. I hope he would have. I did my best. Maybe he would have been embarrassed that I talked so much about him, actually. And I should have talked more about the kids. Good. Okay, so we have 10 minutes left. We will make it. Now, you may have seen on Facebook and Instagram that today I prepared a special apéro. And the reason is it's a little bigger than usual because I've been working really hard all week. I took one day off when I shared those videos and photos with you on Tuesday, the second day of the déconfinement, but after that I was here pretty much working, teaching, etc. So I thought I would treat myself to a fun Sunday in the sun in somewhere magic around Paris. And knowing me, you know it'll be a little place where maybe a lot of people won't be going. And I might do that on Monday as well if there is time. So I got food, because there are no restaurants, no cafes. So I got food, I have backpack. I'm gonna go with my backpack, my picnic. It's gonna be great fun, I can't wait. And I'll be sharing photos, of course, of the places I'll see and the stuff in that backpack, in case some of you are interested. So, let us see l'apéro for today. Let's make it work, whee! Okay, so my apéro today, my friends, is called un buffet campagnard. Now, a buffet campagnard is a buffet-style celebration, kind of laid back, kind of like a picnic on a table. You help yourself, and a buffet campagnard, campagnard means country, right? So everything is quite rustic. So you can expect a selection of charcuterie. So for me, the charcuterie, trusted Opinel knife as a stick to point at things. Here is a pâté that I chose, and I picked a pâté de campagne, one of the most rustic pâtés you can find. And kind of a fancier option here, referred to as une charcuterie pâtissière. So it is charcuterie, but it's also pâtissière, like a pastry, because it's cooked in dough. So it's very nice. And there's some, I can see there are different types of meat, usually white meat in it. And there's some pistachio as well. So this is my selection for the charcuterie. And I've added, of course, le saucisson. And this one is also flavored with pistachio, because I love pistachio, so why not? To go with that, you would have a lot more food on a buffet, of course, but it's just me, unless I make friends on my adventure tomorrow. So I picked a bread that would be rustic bread, pain de campagne. And for the cheese, I went to my one of my fromagers in the area, Beillevaire. It's a chain, and they do a wonderful job. And the lady I know there talked to me into getting this cheese, which is called, I wrote it so you would have it, le secret du couvent bichonné. the convent's secret, bichonner. When you bichonner someone, it means you give them extra care. You take really good care of them. Well, this is actually a cheese that was made, you know, a lot of monks and sisters would make cheese and wine in the monastical orders. And so this cheese is made, used to be made in a monastery in Laval. And the region is, I will show you, it's in the Mayenne. I know you all love that map. So this is 53 here, Laval. You see it's on the western side of France. So this cheese was made there in a monastery. 10 years ago, they stopped making it. And one of the sisters taught the gentleman at Beillevaire how to make it. And bichonner with extra care means they age it longer than the sisters used to age it. And what the lady promised me, because I've never tried it, I haven't tried it yet. What she said is it's a mix between reblochon, tom, you know, those famous cheeses from the mountains, and abondance. Well, I mean, I was sold. She gave me three of my favorite cheeses, the taste of three of my favorite cheeses in one cheese, I'll buy it. So I did. I only got that one this time. And so you would also have cold salads, right? So I went for taboulé because I love taboulé. So there would be a selection of salads. And for dessert, there would be dessert on my campagnard, mon buffet campagnard. So strawberries, I went for the gariguette. This is the number one selling strawberry in France because the season starts very early and they're tasty and very early spring and they're delicious. And I think I treated myself to a very rustic looking apple tart from my favorite pâtissier. So what do you think? Do you think this looks good? Yeah, I don't think I'll starve, eh? This is after a hard week working, I think I deserve it. So I'm going to have it. And for wine, I know I can't leave you without mentioning the wine. This is a wine I bought a couple weeks ago. It's from Le Périgord. Remember the Périgord when I took you there with Josephine Baker in the Dordogne? And this is Le Haut Pays, the upper country. Pays is the old spelling in the Occitan language in southern France. Pays means country, so this, and it's a Merlot, but my I bought it with the cheese and they told me be very careful because it's péchu. She said péchu, which means it's got some kick. So I don't think the cheese will be right for it, but I definitely think the charcuterie and the selection will be just great with it. So I'm gonna pour it without spilling it so I can toast all of you, my friends, and thank you for joining me once again for Apéro with Véro number 8. Let's switch this back. Voila. I know they will tell me when it's time, and I know it's almost time, but we have a couple of minutes left. So I would like you to say, I mean, I would like you to know that I'm very appreciative, you know, of all, having all of you here. I think we went up to 155, 160 people today. So that's excellent. Thank you so much for being here. I am going to try, as always, and capture the replay for you. So I will share it on YouTube and on Facebook. And when you go to the YouTube link, I add all the notes from this presentation, the food, etc., in the video description. So if there are things that weren't clear, they might be there in the video description when you go on YouTube. So I hope you find that helpful. And as for me, I am going to relax and we'll watch tonight my friend Oliver G's The Eiffel Tower with lovely Lina. The pop quiz that they're doing from a very special location at 9 p.m. Paris time tonight. I think it's going to be great fun, and wait till you see where they have crashed for the week. Some people have all the luck. So thank you so much. I have 1 minute left. Merci Georges, à la tienne aussi si tu as du Merlot, du Périgord. You know what? Oh yeah. It's got some kick. Yes, yes. So it will be just fine. Yeah, I'll see you, Oliver. I'll see you in a little while. I'll join you later. Thanks, guys. And you can find me, as always, on Facebook. I'll post a new pictorial travelogue probably on Sunday or on Monday based on my adventures tomorrow. And as always, check me out on Patreon. Your support is very much appreciated, and I need it to continue planning fun events like this one. So counting on you there. And other than that, everybody enjoy a great, wonderful weekend, even if you're still in confinement. And I will be seeing you hopefully next week with new adventures around Paris or France, who knows, okay? So merci beaucoup. It's going to cut in about 2 seconds.